I am Top Verse, and this is the Kathy Knight case. For this story, we are venturing to the land down under, my home country. This Australian tale of psychopathy, hatred, revenge, and unthinkable violence is one of the most disturbing and disgusting stories I've ever stumbled across. It's almost difficult to believe that such people exist. You know how sometimes you taste or smell something super nauseating and just have to get somebody else to smell it or taste it with you because it's so bad? That's kind of why I decided to tell this case. You have to see it to believe it. Katherine Mary Knight was thrust into a world and a family filled with chaos on October 5th, 1955 in Moree, New South Wales. From the moment she breathed her first breath, the world seemed to be against her. Kathy was the product of an affair between her mother, Barbara Rogan, and her father, Ken Knight. Rogan already had four sons, and she met Knight through her former husband. The conservative town they lived in was mortified by the affair. Ken was less of a husband and a father, and more of a barbaric heathen. He was a violent alcoholic who raped Barbara multiple times a day and brutally beat the whole family, often with belts. Barbara frequently discussed details of the rapes with her children and told them how much she hated both men and sex. Katherine was reportedly sexually assaulted by numerous family members, but not her father, until she was 11 years old. These tragedies would help shape her lifelong distrust and disgust with men. With a home life steeped in fear, instability, and complete lack of control over her circumstances, Kathy became a notorious school bully who frequently picked on smaller children. She once attacked a schoolmate with a knife, and a teacher who broke the fight up was injured in the process. At the age of 15, Kathy dropped out of school, never having learned how to read or write, and took an unfulfilling job at a clothing store. 1 year later, Kathy landed her dream job, working in a slaughterhouse removing the internal organs of animals. Kathy loved chopping up animals and working with knives so much that she hung her first set of butcher knives over her head. She never knew when she might need them. It was oddly comforting to be able to take one last look at them before she went to sleep. It's hard to have a healthy view of relationships and sex when you've been sexually assaulted multiple times, your dad rapes your mum, and your mum regularly tells you how much she hates the male species. But Kathy still tried to find love. Or maybe she just tried to find an easy target for her fury. In 1973, Kathy met co-worker David Kellett. They entered into a relationship together, and she promptly gained control of the relationship and dominated David in every way. David frequently got into bar fights, and Kathy would step in to back up her hard-drinking boyfriend. She didn't fear bigger, more powerful men. Kathy eventually earned herself a reputation for threatening violence anytime anyone displeased her. In 1974, the couple got married at Kathy's request. Most likely, the marriage was at her insistence. The couple showed up to the ceremony on a motorcycle, and David was drunk. Instead of passing along heartfelt advice, guidance, or congratulations to a new son-in-law at the wedding, Kathy's mum told him, "You better watch this one, or she'll fucking kill you. Stir her up the wrong way, or do the wrong thing, and you're fucked. Don't ever think of playing up on her. She'll fucking kill you." Barbara added that her daughter has got a screw loose somewhere. Kathy and David's wedding night was nothing if not memorable. Kathy tried to strangle David that night because he was only able to have intercourse with her three times and fell asleep. Mr. and Mrs. Kellett didn't exactly have what you would call a marriage made in heaven. Kathy was vindictive, jealous, and violent. Somewhere along the way, the couple made the absolute worst decision possible: to have children. Being pregnant did nothing to mellow Kathy. With her bun nearly baked in the oven, Kathy once burned all of David's clothes and shoes and smacked him in the back of the head with a frying pan during an argument. In fear for his life, David fled to a neighbor's house where he collapsed from a badly fractured skull. Somehow, Kathy, now behaving as a glowing expectant mother, convinced David not to press charges. The couple's daughter, Melissa Ann, was born in 1976. Shortly thereafter, David decided he'd had enough of his crazy wife. He left Kathy for another woman, and this enraged Kathy. The day after David called it quits, Kathy was spotted pushing Melissa Ann in a baby carriage down Main Street, violently rocking the carriage from side to side, slamming it against the walls and fences. She was admitted to St. Elmo's Hospital in Tamworth and diagnosed with postpartum depression. After spending several weeks in the hospital, Kathy was released, and it immediately became clear that the stint in the psych ward had done nothing to help the deranged woman. Just a day after being released, Kathy took her two-month-old daughter to some railroad tracks and placed her on the railway line. Then, she stole an axe, wandered into town, and threatened the lives of several people. Poor Melissa was found and rescued from the railroad tracks by a man known in the area as Old Ted, just minutes before the train passed. Kathy was arrested and sent to St. Elmo's Hospital yet again, but she signed herself out the next day. Days later, Kathy grabbed her prize knife collection and slashed a woman in the face and demanded that she drive her to Queensland to find David. The woman was able to escape, but before the police arrived, Kathy managed to take a little boy hostage and threaten him with a knife. Police were forced to disarm the raging woman with brooms, and she was admitted to Morisset Psychiatric Hospital. The depth of Kathy's jealousy, vindictiveness, and anger shocked the nurses as they listened to their patient tell them how she planned to kill the mechanic who fixed David's car, which allowed David to leave her, then killed David and his mother when they arrived in Queensland. Upon learning the news, David, his mother, and his new girlfriend fled to Aberdeen. Now, either Kellett was still in love with Kathy, he felt bad for her, or he was too scared to leave her for good, because when Kathy was released from the hospital, David, along with his mother, moved with Kathy to Woodbridge, a suburb of Brisbane. In March 1980, for reasons I will never understand, David and Kathy had a second child together, Natasha Marie. 4 years later, Kathy left David. She moved in with her parents, and then she rented a house in Muswell Brook. She went back to her slaughterhouse job, but she injured her back the following year and went on disability. She moved out of the rented house, and the government provided public housing in Aberdeen. In 1986, Kathy Knight met her next victim. David Saunders was a minor, and the two fell madly in love during a whirlwind courtship. Within months, David Saunders moved in with Kathy and her two children. However, Kathy was furious when Saunders decided to keep his apartment, even though she was living with her. She became jealous and suspicious, and the couple's relationship soon took a nosedive. Kathy, never one to suppress her true emotions and evil nature, once got so angry at Saunders that she slit the throat of his two-month-old dingo puppy right in front of him to show him what she was capable of. The couple stayed together, however, and welcomed a baby girl later that year. Following the birth of Sarah, Saunders put a deposit on a house, which Kathy paid off with workers' compensation. In true psychotic fashion, she decorated the family's new abode with animal skins, horns, skulls, rusty animal traps, leather jackets, old boots, machetes, rakes, and pitchforks. Not a single inch of the house was left uncovered. One day in 1989, Kathy got into an argument with Saunders and retaliated by first hitting him in the face with an iron and then stabbing him with a pair of scissors. Saunders moved out, but soon returned home, only to find that Kathy had cut his clothing into pieces. Months later, he returned again to visit his daughter, but Kathy had been granted an apprehended violence order against him. In 1990, Kathy became pregnant by a 43-year-old co-worker, John Chillingworth. The following year, she gave birth to a son, Eric. It was the one and only romantic relationship Kathy would ever have that didn't include outrageous acts of violence. Chillingworth left Kathy after 3 years when he discovered that she was having a long-time affair with a man named John Price. Kathy's relationship with John Price started out fairly normal. The couple decided to live together in 1995. Price was the father of two older children who lived with him, and they seemed to like Kathy. Price's job as a miner was sufficient enough to keep Kathy comfortable. Kathy's comfort didn't last long, though. When she asked Price to marry her, he declined, and you can probably guess how Kathy reacted to the rejection. By the time Price hooked up with Kathy, He was well aware of her reputation. Maybe he thought their relationship would be different, or maybe he expected a certain level of abuse, but he never expected that falling in love with Kathy would have the consequences that it did. When Kathy didn't convince Price to marry her, she stole money from him and purchased an engagement ring for herself. When Price still refused to marry him, she went after his livelihood. Kathy knew that Price had still been stealing expired first aid kits out of the trash at work, so she reported him. Price was fired after 17 years on the job. Price kicked Kathy out to the curb, but they got back together just a few months later. There was a great deal of arguing during this time, and Kathy was determined to make Price's life as miserable as she could. She tried to take control of the house, which Price owned, fought with Price's children, and even lied and told friends and co-workers that David had molested her daughters. During one particularly heated argument, Kathy stabbed Price. Finally realizing the level of danger he was in, Price filed for a restraining order against Kathy on February 29th, 2000, but was told the process might take several weeks. That very same day, Price warned friends and co-workers that if she didn't show up for work in the morning, it was because Kathy had killed him. Price knew his girlfriend wanted him dead. On the night of February 29th, 2000, the same day Price applied for a protective order, Kathy went to his house while he was sleeping. The two had sex, and Price immediately dozed off. You know how much Kathy likes that. Gripping one of her recently sharpened knives, Kathy plunged the blade into her sleeping partner. Price leapt from the bed and ran out of the house in abject terror. But crazy Kathy overpowered him and stabbed him more than 37 times. Detective Senior Constable Peter Anthony Muscio stated,
"I remember walking down the hallway, and at about shoulder height there were all these blood spatter marks on the walls. To me, it's indicative of each attack. He's absolutely fighting for his life. The bloke's just had a bonk in the bed when he wakes up, and then stab, stab, stab. He's getting up. There's arterial spurting on the robe and on the bed and on the doorway. There's a bloodied handprint or swipe on the western side of the door near the dressing table, and blood around the light switch. It looks like he's tried to turn the light switch on. And then all down the hallway, there's bloody handprints everywhere. And he's almost made it. He's opened the front door. The door is shut. There's blood staining trajectory again, flicking out across the front door. He's almost made it, but he wouldn't have survived. He would have been absolutely horrified, terrified, probably terrified more than horrified, trying to get out, and all the time being stabbed."
But when Kathy started stabbing Price, she was just getting started. She was about to become one of the most notorious killers in Australian history, and the most notorious female killer in the country. Kathy was skilled at butchering animals, and Price's lifeless body was about to become her next project. First, she skinned Price and hung the skin from a hook in the living room. He was skinned post-mortem. Then she decapitated him and tossed him into a pot and cooked him with some vegetables. Kathy cooked several other body parts of Price's body, including his buttocks, and served them as steak along with the vegetables, a baked potato, and gravy. She planned to serve the meals to Price's children and placed the food on two separate plates on a table, along with handwritten spiteful notes. But she wasn't quite finished yet. After setting out place cards for Price's children, she positioned the rest of Price's skin body on his favorite chair, crossing his legs. Although Kathy slaughtered and cooked her man, she didn't eat any of him herself. Sensing how much trouble she was in, Kathy instead opted to take a handful of pills in an attempt to kill herself. She lay down beside the headless, skinned corpse of her love and passed out, but didn't die. Fortunately for the oldest Price children, they never had the chance to dine on their dad. They had been gone the previous night and hadn't yet returned. When a neighbor noticed that Price's car was still in the driveway and he hadn't gone to work, the neighbor knocked on his door to check on him. No one answered. And the neighbor noticed there was blood on the doorknob. She immediately phoned the police. When Kathy came home, she claimed to have no memory of the crime. She was to stand trial in October 2001, but suddenly changed her plea to guilty and was sentenced to life in prison. The first Australian woman to ever receive the sentence. Cannibal Katherine Knight's reign of terror was over. Now in her early 60s, she is currently serving her sentence at Silverwater Women's Correctional Centre. Katherine Mary Knight was a miserable woman who had a miserable upbringing, and she took out her rage on the people she was supposed to love the most. She was terrified of being alone and terrified of losing control. But she was also a sane woman who knew what she was doing. Her comments regarding not signing her artwork suggest she knew it was wrong, but that doesn't mean she has empathy. Some people are just evil, that's what I believe. Why Kathy Knight turned out to be such a glaring example of evil, we may never know. And that's all for today, guys. If you like this video, please subscribe. See you for now.